No, as I said before, I don't think that the people who were in charge, such as General Putnam and those folk, I think that his confidence was such that he knew that this was going to work somehow. With a background such as they had, having fought to the Revolution, they knew hard times before. So really, what the average settler, the family person, would have felt was a disaster in the making, they would have had a lot more confidence because they had come through hard times before. But I would think probably the hardest times would be the time of famine in 1790, and then later, of course, when the Indian Wars broke out in Anst. War had been rumbling, and they had tried so hard to prevent it, but then when they saw that there wasn't any hope of prevention, and there was that period of time right after the Big Bottom Massacre that we need to talk about, that if you know where the Indian tribes are located, we need some background on this. The Indian tribes in the Ohio Valley, many times students will ask me, what tribe was in the Ohio Valley? And I think they're thinking in terms of the Old West, where you could say this was Blackfoot country or this was Crow country or so forth. That wasn't the case in the Ohio Valley. In the Ohio Valley in 1788, when Rufus Putnam arrived here, there would have been a great mixture of Indians just kind of ranging through the area. They would have been, for the most part, displaced because their homelands had been uprooted for one reason or another. So let me tell you just a little bit about the Indians, the number of Indians, and who would have been here. Now, if you can imagine a map of Ohio bordered by New York, Pennsylvania, and the map as we know it, even though it wasn't that way then, up in New York area, we had the mighty Iroquois Confederation. And the Iroquois Confederation actually consisted of six tribes. It was the Onondaga, the Cayuga, the Oneida, the Mohawk, the Seneca, and then later the Tuscarawas. So all those tribes had, for the most part, been pro-British. So after the Revolutionary War, they were displaced. Sullivan's campaign burned their villages. Many of them fled to Detroit, which was a British fort at that time, but many more of them filtered down to the Ohio Valley. Well, then up from the south, we had the Shawnee, and over on what is now the border of Ohio and Indiana, we would have had the Wabash tribes, the Pottawatomie, the Sac, those tribes. Coming in from the East Coast, which had once been on the East Coast, were the Delaware Indians. And so they had infiltrated over through here simply because the civilization on the East Coast had pushed them farther to the west. And then from the north, up from the Great Lakes, came the Ottawa, the Wyandotte, and the Northern tribes. And so if I actually had a map here to show you, you would see that all these tribes were kind of being pushed into the land that we now know as Ohio. And because they were being pushed, they were displaced people. They weren't living what, quote, would have been normal lives had they been left in their homelands to do what it was they had done for generations. And because of this displacement and this being pushed, as it were, by white settlers, let's say they weren't in a very good mood. They were getting tired of it. I always thought perhaps that the Indians may have hoped during the Revolution that the British and these new people who called themselves Americans would just kind of kill each other off, and then the Indians' life could go on as it had been before. But by 1788, the Revolution was over, that hadn't happened. And the Indians, all these tribes that I've named, for example, if you had gone out into the Ohio country as a hunter during 1788 and met a party of Indian hunters, there may have been several different tribes of men represented there. They may not even have spoken the same language. They may be communicating through sign language with one another, but they would have been hunting together. And if you were extremely unlucky and met a war party, that might be true of the war party also. They may have been men from many different tribes. So there's no easy answer as to what one tribe was in the Ohio Valley. And of course, each one of these tribes had their own sympathies, their own fears, their own background. And if it sounds like mass confusion, that's my point, it was. And of course, you know, we hear a lot about civilization, the Civil War being a battle of brother against brother, And you know, in a sense, the Indian Wars were the same thing because the whites had been here since the Pilgrims landed. And the Indians, of course, had been here since antiquity. There was plenty of time for alliances, marriages, deep friendships, all that to develop. And so when the time finally came to choose sides, as it were, are you going to be an American and fight as a settler to settle the West, or are you going to fight as an Indian to claim the homeland that these people are trying to take away from you? When that moment of decision came, it was a heart-wrenching decision that broke people's hearts and split families. And I don't believe that we really appreciate that as we do, as I say, maybe during the Civil War, when that issue split families and broke hearts. But that was very true of the Indian War.
Okay, so we're going to take it up from that point where we're discussing low point and relating particular stories to explain that.
When we're talking about a low point in the pioneers' lives during that period, it really depends upon the pioneer, because some of them, as I mentioned before, Rufus Putnam and I believe most of the men of the Ohio Company had real confidence in this whole movement. They had seen hard times before. They knew they were going to see hard times again. They were prepared. They had seen famine. They had seen Indian War. They had fought with Indians. They had fought against Indians. They had fought French. They had fought British. And so hard times really wasn't anything new to them. But there were settlers who came here for one reason or another. And one of my favorite people is Ichabod Nye. And I always say I like Ichabod because I think he would have been, he was the kind of pioneer I probably would have been, because he was scared to death most of the time and complained all the time. And so why was he here? Good question. What motivated Ichabod to come? Well, it was very simple. His father-in-law, who was Ben Tupper, who was a very good friend of Rufus Putnam, who was one of those men who had the military background and the confidence to make this bold move into the West. His father-in-law was going to come. He was going to bring his wife. He was going to bring his other daughter, his unmarried daughter, Rowena. And it just so happened that Ichabod was married to the eldest daughter, Minerva. Well, Minerva said her heart would surely break if she had to be separated from her family. And so Ben Tupper said, Ichabod, come with us. Well, what are you going to do? There you are, with a broken-hearted wife and a strong-minded father-in-law. You're on your way west in no time, but you don't like it. Back on the East Coast, Ichabod had been a farmer, a very quiet, well-mannered, well-behaved farmer. He had fought in the Revolution as a common soldier. He wasn't an officer. And here's one point that I often like to make about soldiers. Many people get the impression that the average settler on the frontier was like Daniel Boone. He was a crack shot. He was fearless. He could really take care of himself. This wasn't necessarily so, because even a man like Ichabod, who had a background in the Revolution, they had been trained to fight with muskets. And as you probably know, with a musket, the men fight in regiments, and they simply line up, and when their commander says fire, they all shoot in one particular direction and hit something. Well, if enough men with muskets shoot in one direction, they're going to hit something. Well, this does not work out in the wilderness, where that you are up against Indian sharpshooters with long rifles, or you're trying to bring down game. So Ichabod, even though he was a soldier and had fought using a musket, he was no match for pioneer life, and he knew it. And so he was very reluctant and very pessimistic about the whole thing. He didn't see how it could work, and he didn't see how he was ever going to make a living after he got here. And so when we talk about low points, Ichabod's life was just one low point after another. And I believe there were probably many settlers just like him who came for reasons maybe beyond their control, maybe because their families, or maybe they didn't realize just how bad it was going to be till they got here. And once they were here, they had spent all their money to get here, and they were stuck. You know, often people will say to me, well, when they came and they saw what it was like on the frontier, why didn't they go back east? Well, there wasn't anything back east for them. Their property was gone. They probably had sold it to get money to come here. And physically, it's not as easy to get back east once you're in the Ohio Valley on foot, maybe with a team of oxen, as it is to stay and tough it out. So you had a lot of people who were simply toughing it out. And then you had a lot of other people like Rufus Putnam, I believe, and like the scouts and rangers who were such colorful pictures on people on the frontier. They, many of them loved it. There was one in particular that Ichabod met on the trail when he was coming here from the from Pittsburgh cross country. He met Joshua Fleehart. And Joshua Fleehart was a big man, well over 6 foot. And of course, back then people weren't quite as big as they are now. So 6 foot man was a good sized man. And Josh Fleehart had a special long rifle made just for him, big. And Ichabod said it was so heavy he could scarcely lift it. But Josh Fleehart described this as God's purest country. You know, here he was out in the wilderness, surrounded by hostile Indians, rough terrain, bad weather, and, you know, chilled to the bone, wet, cold. And he's hunched around the campfire telling this other fellow that this is God's best country and how wonderful it is to live here. So for Josh Fleehart, there was never a low point. Life was good. And as far as we know, he loved it all his days here. So so high points and low points depended on who you were and how much hardship you'd seen before you came here. Now, the women and children, I can't imagine. So many of those women had, they had not been wealthy, but they had been maybe what you would call genteel. They had had, certainly they had had curtains on their windows and rugs on their floors. They could look out the window and see the lights of their neighbors. They probably went to church on Sunday and to market on Monday. They lived a fairly ordinary life. And then all of a sudden, here they are in a wilderness that they couldn't have imagined. You know, we've talked many times about the trees and the depth of the forest of the Ohio Valley. And remember that these are New Englanders. And they do have trees back in New England, but they didn't have trees like they had here. They had forests back in New England. But these were village dwellers and also lived in coastal cities. And when they got out here to these huge virgin forests, it was dark and menacing. And, you know, we consider going out into the forest today as kind of a resting, relaxation period. Well, if you don't know what's out there, if you can't see, and if there's all these noises, one fellow I remember reading a journal where he talked about the noises. He camped out at night and he heard all these weird noises. There were screech owls and hoot owls and coyotes and wolves. And he said it was just the most frightening thing you ever heard. He said it sounds like the devil's out there, that the devil's work is being carried on just beyond the circle of my campfire. And so when you think of coming into that kind of a country that is so very foreign to you, and I cannot imagine what the women and children must have thought when they got deep into this country and saw what they were going to live in, very rude cabins. You know, in Marietta, we often take people to Campus Martius to see the Rufus Putnam House. And I always tell people, bear in mind that when you look at the Rufus Putnam House, that you are not looking at the average settler's home. You're looking at Rufus Putnam, who was head of the Ohio Company. This is the equivalent of the governor's mansion. And your ancestors and mine probably didn't live in a house like that. My ancestors came here from Connecticut in an ox cart. And the family story goes that the first year they turned the ox cart up and made a shed out of the ox cart. They lived underneath the ox cart till they could get a cabin built. And so that's the way the average settler was living, in the darkness. No lights, just think how very dark that alone would have been. And then there were the Indians. Many of the East Coast people had seen Indians on the East Coast, but not like the Indians we have here. The Indians we had here were very foreign to them because they were, they just really had never seen anything like them. If you listen to the contrast of their music, when I talk to groups of students, I have a tape of Mozart who was, music of that contemporary period. And then I also have a tape of an Indian powwow that I play to contrast. And just something like that can really, really, it would be like us starting a settlement among Martians or something. They had really never seen anything to compare with either the surroundings or the natives of the area. And the fact that these natives might be potentially hostile was a terrifying thought. And they would have known, for example, in Marietta, the first year or so, there was probably about 200 people. And they would have known that they were outnumbered by Indians. And all the horror stories that you've ever heard about Indians would have been part of their folklore too. And you know how stories are. They're bad enough to start with, but the time they get around, they're 1,000 times worse. And so they would have had all this baggage. And so when we think about life on the frontier and when we judge some of their reactions, because they were a very violent people in many respects, we need to know that they lived their life in constant fear of animals, of disease, sudden death from the Indians, accident. So I'm not a doctor of either body or soul, but I do know that if you live in a state of constant alert for long periods of time, it does things to you physically and mentally. So that's the kind of thing we want to think about when we're talking about how they would have felt and their high points and their low points.
If we're talking about low point, what would you say for the community, for the Seminole of Marietta, as a group mindset, was the low point?
Probably it would have been, first of all, the famine, which occurred in 1790, which their good neighbor across the river, Isaac Williams, saved their lives. That would have been a definite low point, because you see, the first year that they came, the first thing they needed to do when they got here was to provide shelter. And this is a kind of a long answer to a short question, but I used to always wonder why, when I first started to read, as a child, read about pioneers, I would wonder why they would travel in the winter. Because it seems to me if I were going to cross Allegheny Mountains, I'd do it in summer. But they would travel in the winter so that they would be at their destination in the spring. Well, of course, the point being, they had to get there in the spring so they'd get those crops in the ground immediately. Because that's what their life depended on. And if the crops failed, well, you couldn't run down to the corner grocery. If you ran out, you were literally in a bad fix if those crops failed. And then, as I've said before, these were New Englanders, and they were used to dealing with the New England climate. Now, spring doesn't come so early in New England, but it is dependable, they tell me. Once it gets there, it's there. But here in the Ohio Valley, we all know that spring can fool you. I mean, it can get nice and warm in the first part of March, even the last of February. And you think, oh, spring's here, it's time to plant our crops. And then what happens? Late frost, and everything's dead. And a misjudgment like that now is just a minor annoyance. But back then, it was a difference between life and death. And so that year, that first year, they had 130 acres planted before the summer was over. Now, they didn't cultivate the ground like we would cultivate it. They just simply poked holes in it and planted their corn. But they did have it planted, and it was a pretty decent crop. But then the next year was a different story, because not only did they have a late frost that killed their first planting, but then they had a very wet summer, and their crops rotted in the ground. And as they watched those crops rot, the fathers and mothers thinking about their children and the winter that was coming, it must have been close to sheer terror in their hearts, because, you could just see it. It was like watching something creep up on you that you had no control over. And it must have been a horrible time for them. And by that time, by the 1789 and 90, during those times of crop failure, they would have been aware that Indian hostilities were getting worse and worse by the day. Their relationship with the Indians was deteriorating. I mean, you didn't have to be one of the city fathers to know that. That would have been common knowledge. So not only were you being fed those horror stories of the frontier, coming up from the dark and bloody ground of Kentucky, coming down from Pennsylvania, where we had stories of Dutchman's Flats and Cherry Valley, the massacre at Wyoming Valley in Pennsylvania. All those stories were part of that coming down. The same thing's going to happen to us. And then meanwhile, your crops are rotting the ground and you're going to starve. And so it must have been a terrible, terrible time. So I would say for the common family, the ordinary person, that must have been kind of a low point. And of course, they were saved that winter of 1790 by Isaac Williams, who lived across the river on the Williamstown shore. Now, Isaac Williams had, he and his wife, Rebecca had been a Tomlinson. And she and her brothers had homesteaded over there on that Virginia shore. And because they had come early, and they tell me that the soil over there is slightly different than it is over on the Marietta side. It's sandier, drains better. And so not only had they been there longer, but they had a different type of soil to deal with, and their crops were more successful. And so he had a bumper crop that year, the same year that the Marietta settlers' crops were rotting in the ground. And they say speculators came down. Of course, they're always speculators are ever with us. They came down and offered him unheard of prices for his corn, $1.25 a bushel. I mean, he could have been a rich man. But Isaac Williams said no, that he would sell it to the people who needed it. And if he didn't have money to pay for it, that was okay. And he would only sell as much as you needed. For example, if you had been a man and wife and two children who had lots of money, and over here there was a man and wife and 10 children who had no money, Isaac would have sold less to the small family than he would have to the large family because they needed it worse. And so he used his bounty to such good effect. And said later, he said that he would never fatten his wallet on another man's misery. So Isaac pulled him out of it that first year, but it was a close call. I read where that they drank sassafras tea, and they had bush tea, which meant they just simply broke off twigs and put it in hot water and drank whatever came off of it. And bush tea and corn pone, and that was just about it. And of course you say, well, there was plenty of meat out there. They could just go out and kill deer and buffalo and whatnot. By that time, the Indians had begun kind of a subtle campaign against the whites by driving the game away and killing the game needlessly, slaughtering it, leaving it lay even, in order to cut down on what the settlers had access to. So that particular time, not only was the crops failing, but the game was kind of getting scarce too. So that would have been a low point for everybody. Now, what was going through the minds of Rufus Putnam and Ben Tupper and Nathan Goodale and those men who were the shakers and movers? They had faced famine before. I'll bet they were worried, seriously worried. I don't believe they really were in despair. I think they had come through so many tight spots before, they thought this is just another one. You know, we're going to get through this. And I can visualize Ichabod and his neighbors saying, I don't know whether we're going to get through this or not. So that would have been, they would have said, oh, it can't get any worse than this. And then a couple more years, well, no, that was 1790. The next year is when the Indian, we always kind of date the Indian War as starting with Big Bottom in 1791 and going to 1794 with the Battle of Fallen Timbers with Anthony Wayne, and then the signing of the Treaty of Greenville.
Now, how did the smallpox epidemic work into this whole thing? When did that happen and how did that?
Well, epidemics, smallpox and otherwise, were always hanging over. They spoke of the fever. And in Marietta, we had a local doctor, Edgar Northrup, who was very interested in history and a medical doctor. And he used to come to the library where I worked, and I would describe the symptoms that I had read, you know, the people had. And I'd say, Dr. Edgar, what do you think they had? And then he'd tell me, you know, what he thought it was. And in many cases, he said it was probably dysentery. Could have been malaria brought up in the South. Many cases, it was smallpox, indeed. Sometimes it was bad water. Many times it was what you and I would call the flu, the stomach flu. And of course, you'd become dehydrated and die from it. So something that would be a minor annoyance now would could literally wipe out a whole family or a whole group of children back then. And so, yes, there was a smallpox epidemic here. And in fact, one of our more famous women who come, Mary Gardner Owen, who came here in 1790, or no, I believe she came in 1780. She came in 1788. She came midsummer that year. The men of the Ohio Company arrived April the 4th. The first families arrived in August, but in there in May and June, there were groups of people came. And Mary Gardner Owen had come with Judge Varnum, who was suffering from tuberculosis. She had evidently come as his nurse. And so she was here, and I don't know what her background was, but it was definitely nursing. She definitely was one who knew how to care for the sick. So then a few years later, when the smallpox epidemic hit, why, she nursed the people through and did such a service that she is the only woman who was given donation lands, 100 acres. That was the rule was they would give 100 acres to any frontiersman who would defend the country for a year and also make certain improvements. So they gave that 100 acres to Mary Gardner Owen, even though she wasn't a frontiers man. They said she had was as good a frontiers person as any that ever lived, and the enemy against which she had fought was as fearsome as any man ever faced. So, but smallpox, they, and you know, one interesting note too I found when they were raising armies, that the recruiters would go into, of course, when you were raising an army, you'd take anybody who couldn't stand up and hold a gun. And but the recruiters preferred pock-marked men, because if you had the marks of smallpox, you know, of course it left your skin terribly pitted. If you had the marks of smallpox on you, it meant you had survived it, you were immune, and they wouldn't lose you, or you wouldn't be apt to start an epidemic in the camp. And so I found that the recruiters preferred, they looked for pock-marked men to recruit into their armies for the frontier.
Okay.
There are so many misconceptions about the frontier, about the people who were on the frontier. And I think one of the most dangerous misconceptions we have is that the people were all alike. You know, you have white people and you have Indian people. And we know that all white people aren't alike. We wouldn't make the mistake, for example, of saying all Europeans are alike. We know very well that Spaniards look different, talk different than Norwegians, you know. And that was very true of the of what we refer to as the settlers. And it was equally true of the Indians. They were not all stereotypical people, a bit more than anyone else was stereotypical. But I think when you talk about the Marietta settlement, there was such a mixture of people here. Just think about it a little bit. We have, we've talked many times already about Rufus Putnam and Ben Tupper and the New Englanders who were officers in the Revolution. They were members of the Society of the Cincinnati. They were, many of them were members of the Masonic Lodge. They had, if they had not been wealthy back on the East Coast, they had at least lived a rather genteel, even-tempered life, so to speak. Many of them were very well-educated. Rufus Putnam was the exception to this. He was not a well-educated man. But the others were very well-educated with a background in Greek and Latin, even. I mean, you can look around over Marietta and see some of the names that they gave to the mounds and things like that, and see that they had quite a background as far as the education was concerned. So we had that group of people, and they were the group of people whose goal it was to lift up the best of New England and bring it across the mountains and set it down in a new country. And it was going to be just the perfect place. And this was their goal, and this is what they had in mind. Well, it was a lot harder than it looked, you know? And you couldn't do that by yourself. So you needed people who understood this new country. They understood New England. They understood government. They understood Greek and Latin. What they didn't understand was the frontier. So they needed help on the frontier. They needed somebody who could shoot straight with a long rifle. They needed somebody who had a better grasp of the Indian situation and the hardships involved. So they hired scouts and rangers. Scouts and rangers were recruited from men who had grown up on other frontiers, either down in Kentucky, dark and bloody ground, they called it, not for nothing. It was a hard place to live. Pennsylvania, where you'd had much Indian unrest, New York, men who had grown up on the frontier and who really knew frontier life. I've mentioned Josh Fleehart before. He was such a man. Peter Niswonger, Joel Oakes, Lou Wetzel. Many of these people who had grown up on the frontier who understood the frontier perfectly. So they needed those people. So they hired many of them to serve as scouts and rangers. And now there was one thing, well, there was many problems actually, but there was one big problem with all this. The people from New England were trying very, very hard to avoid an Indian war. They did not want a bloodbath a bit more than anybody else did. And so they were trying with treaties to keep the lid on this thing. They had treaties at Fort McIntosh, at Fort Stanwyck, at the mouth of Miami. They hoped to avoid an Indian war. They did not want to antagonize these Indians. Well, when you hire these border scouts who have grown up on the frontier, they hate Indians. They don't want to sign a treaty with Indians. They want to kill them all. So if you're Rufus Putnam or someone who has charge of all this, or General Harmer at Fort Harmer, or Major Dowdy, who was in charge of Fort Harmer, you have the job then of keeping the Indians satisfied by treaties, honest or dishonest, as it might be. But on the other hand, you have to keep your scouts and rangers in line because you don't want them out there killing Indians. This is no way to keep the lid on things, so to speak. So you have a really difficult situation. It's kind of like a powder keg. You never know when the wrong word, the wrong temper, somebody's going to get drunk, somebody's going to gamble, somebody's going to lie to somebody, something's going to blow up. And so that just kept things at a constant level of tension all the time. And so you can see the variety of people that there were here. And then to add to that, so now you have the New Englanders, you have the Indians with all their various backgrounds, you have the scouts and rangers with their background, and into that mix in 1790, we have a number of French people who come here from France who are also mixed in with this. You also, we'll talk about them a little bit more later on, I'm sure. But besides the French people, many of the German soldiers, the Hessians, who had fought with the British during the Revolution, had also stayed behind. They had seen this was a good country, and they had stayed behind, and many of them came down into the Ohio Valley. And so just as we talked a few minutes ago about the mixture of Indians that we had here in the Ohio Valley, we also had quite a mixture of Europeans here, of different backgrounds, different ethnic groups, different religions, certainly different cultures, you might say. And this, to me, is one of the most interesting things that come out of studying history in the Ohio Valley, is the complete mix of people that we had. And, of course, you can imagine some of the problems and some of the tensions that grew alongside this mixture of people. Talk a little bit about the French who came. The deal, of course, we need to understand that back in Europe during this time period, things are a mess. If you think things are a mess in the Ohio Valley, they're a worse mess back in Europe. The French Revolution is brewing. Life is dangerous. Life is tense. And everybody over there knows that there's a bloodbath in the offing, you know, that you just can't help but see the storm clouds gathering. In the area that's now Germany, we have, I believe it was Prince Frederick, who's gathering the princes together to fight against Austria. There's riots in England for one reason or another. I believe Turkey and Russia is at war about this time. So there's all this turmoil in Europe. So during the time that all this is happening on the frontier, people are literally pouring into America just as fast as they can get here. You know, I often look at those little ships and I think, what in the world would possess a person to get in one of those ships and cross an ocean? I mean, I wouldn't cross the Ohio River in one of them, let alone an ocean. And yet, when you consider what was happening in Europe, you can see what they were running. These people were running with their lives, and they were pouring into America, and many of them were coming down the Ohio River into the Ohio Valley and settling. And so, of course, that brings up another problem that Rufus Putnam had to deal with. That, well, really, it wasn't Rufus so much that dealt with it. It was General Harmon who had to deal with it before. Would be the squatters who came into the Ohio Valley before the men of the Ohio Company ever got here. You know, we've been talking 1788, but if you go back 20 or 30 years, I know the folks at Steubenville always say to us who are from Marietta, they say, ah, you're not the first settlement. There were people in Steubenville long before there were people in Marietta. And you know, they're right, because there were people all up and down the Ohio Valley who came here long before Rufus Putnam organized the men of the Ohio Company for that trip. And of course that led to the establishment of Fort Harmon, because I often tell the school kids that most of the time the forts that you read about were to protect the settlers from the Indians. And in the case of Fort Harmon, it was to protect the Indians from the settlers. And the story behind that being is that the squatters were coming down. All these different people who had immigrated in across the Atlantic were coming in, and they were moving right on through New England because there wasn't much land there for grabs, and they were coming on down into the Ohio Valley and settling, and illegally. And this was doing two things. It was, in many cases, they would deal with the Indians, fight with the Indians, and cause trouble. Most cases, they got along pretty well with the Indians. But the new government of the United States after the Revolution, they were worried that these people were going to cause trouble with the Indians. And as I said before, they were trying hard to establish treaties and to peaceably get this land and settle it. And then the other thing these people were doing, they were going to claim land that was government land. And of course, they weren't paying taxes or anything like that. And so the goal was the new United States government, who were really, you know, they were in a shaky position, and they needed to establish tax-paying landowners. Well, first they needed to get it surveyed, sold, get people on the land who would pay taxes and support the government. Well, these squatters weren't going to do any of that. They were just going to settle in here. So in, I think, about 1784, the Indian agent, Richard Butler, came down the river, and he looked the whole situation over, and he saw all these campfires and these lights back there in the woods along the Ohio Valley. And so he went back and told him, he said, you know, you need somebody down there on that Ohio River to look after things. And he had seen the site where Fort Harmon eventually stood, and it was built. And if you look at that bend in the river right there at Marietta and Harmer, you can see that there's good view down the river and up the river. It's a good place for a fort. And he recommended that to General Harmer. And he said, you know, you need to get somebody down there where you can go to these cabins and tell them to get out of there. But that's Indian land. It's going to be government land, and get off of it, scram. And of course, they didn't scram easily. There was a big settlement at the Steubenville, and one was called Carpenter Station, and the fellow who was the guiding light there was named called Boss Carpenter, and he was the boss. And it was reported that he said, when we fights fierce, and we stands hard. And so that was the kind of person that they were up against. They would go, the soldiers from after Fort Harmon was built, the soldiers would go and burn the cabins and drive the settlers out, and then build them back. Or they would fight. So they had this constant tension with the squatters on the frontier, as well as the Indians. So you see this great mix of people, the squatters, who were in many cases illiterate, Many case times they did trade with the Indians peaceably. Many times they didn't. Many times they cheated the Indians, got them drunk, caused fights. Many of them, though, were good, hardworking farmers that did not want to be driven from their land. So you had those people. You had the New Englanders who were going to create this utopia on the frontier. And then you had the settlers, so the scouts and rangers from Pennsylvania and New York who hated Indians with a passion. And then coming into this, we had this mixture added to the French that came here. And I'd started out to tell you that story here, and I got off on a tangent. But the French were kind of sold a bill of goods. There was a couple of fellas. One's name was Joel Barlow.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you want to change
tapes? Yeah, why don't we change tapes at this point before you get started on
okay.
that?
It's a point. Yeah, you're
and then we'll.
This is a good time.
Roll. Okay.
About 1789 or 90, there, of course, as we've talked before, the situation in France, especially, was particularly grim. It was the French Revolution hadn't really occurred yet. It was brewing, so to speak. And it was a dangerous time. It was a time of great hardship, betrayal, famine in Europe, as well as disease. And so France was not the best place to be during that time period. And so during that time period, there was a couple of fellows who, one of them's name was Joel Barlow. And historians are still arguing about, was Joel Barlow an officer and a gentleman, or was he a scoundrel and a land speculator? And they haven't quite settled that yet, and I'm sure we won't settle that today. But in any event, Joel Barlow and his friend, whose name, I kid you not, was William Playfair, he and William Playfair set up the Scioto Company. And they went to France, and they sold land to the French, who were only too glad to buy land in a new country. And Joel Barlow and William Playfair described it glowingly. They said it was the most wonderful country that God ever made. That, the woods were full of game. You could just fill your table with all the meat you could want. Bear in mind that in France there were famines and all kinds of trouble. The air was fresh and pure. You could drink water from the streams at a time when the sewers were running in the streets of Paris. Beautiful, beautiful country. Why, he said a man could build a cabin as easily as a pretty maid might pluck flowers in the garden. Now, I've never built a cabin, but I don't think it's quite that easy. And besides all that, there was absolutely no threat anywhere. Now, there were a few Indians, but then that they were friendly. Everybody over here loved one another. And so the ending of all this was this masterful salesmanship that 500 Frenchmen who had never been off the streets of Paris in their lives, probably, professional men, doctors, lawyers, artists, hat makers, bakers, bought land in the new country from the Scioto Company. They sold everything they had, and they brought their families, they gave the money over, and they got their families ready, got them on a ship, and headed for the new world, to this utopia, to escape the trouble that's brewing back in France. Well, now that was great, except for several things. Number one, the Scioto Company really didn't have any land. The land they had sold had already been bought by the Ohio Company. There wasn't any land where they had sold it. And of course, the business about the Indians and the log cabins and the plentiful game was just a little bit more complicated than they had been led to believe. And so what happened in September of 1790, September with winter coming, and winter coming back then was a little bit more menacing than winter coming now, got off the boat at Alexandria, 500 of these French people who had never probably been off the streets of Paris in their life, who had never seen an Indian, who had never been in the wilderness, who couldn't shoot, who couldn't chop with an axe, who couldn't do any of these necessary survival skills. And there they were. Well, what do you know? William Playfair and Joel Barlow was nowhere to be seen. They were just there. Well, it was a moment of panic. And And so George Washington sent word to Rufus Putnam, and I'm not sure what the word said. I think he probably said, Rufus, think of something quick. And so Rufus did. They came down the river on a flatboat, the Frenchmen did. Many of them went off at Marietta, and many more of them went on down to the southern tip of the Ohio Company's Purchase, where Rufus Putnam sent his soldiers to build them some cabins, and they settled down there in a place they called the City of the Gauls, or Gallipolis. And, but many of them stayed here in Marietta. And so we talked a little bit ago about how versatile, what a mixture of people we had in the Ohio Valley. And so now we added these French-speaking people to it. And there's wonderful stories told about them. They had such spirit. There's some wonderful stories. I don't know whether you're going to cover the Gallipolis area with this or not, but there's wonderful stories coming out of there. Just, you know, they were such happy people and survived against all odds. And to kind of give you a feel for the kind of people they were, there was this one family, and I'm not sure just exactly how you pronounce their names, because you know our Eastern Ohio tongues do strange things to French words, but we called them the Therrys, T-H-I-E-R-R-Y. And however it might have been pronounced in France, we pronounce it Therry here, Mr. Therry and his wife, and their two children. And so they came here. He'd been a baker back in France. And as I said before, he had no knowledge of the frontier. He probably had the clothes that he had stood up in and very little else because he'd spent all his money. And so when they got here to Marietta, of course, by that time it was late September and nights starting to get cold, they didn't even have any place to sleep. And so over at Fort Harmer, they had an ammunition bunker down next to the fence, next to the palisades, and they kept it down there because powder is dangerous, it could explode. But then the Indian tension was growing on the frontier, the threat of Indian attack, and they thought it was probably safer to dig another hole and bring the powder back closer. The danger of the Indians was greater than the danger powder. This left a big hole in the ground out next to the fort, the wall of the fort in Fort Harmer. And the story goes that the Therry family spent their first winter in the new country in that hole in the ground with boards over their head for a roof. And when spring came, why, he came out and looked around, and somebody told him that those cattails growing over there in the field, that if you take the cattails and do this, you can get a pretty passable flour out of them. And he persuaded somebody else to loan him some real flour, some ground flour, coarse as that would have been. And you know, the first thing you know, he had a fairly decent loaf of bread baking right here in Marietta. I think Marietta Settlement may have been one of the few settlements on the frontier to have their own French bakery. And in due time, he became quite a well-to-do man on the frontier, just starting. You want to talk about starting from nothing, living in a hole in the ground and starting from nothing. And but he made it with cheerful, you know, good outlook on life. And there's a wonderful story told about him, I think it was a year or two later after that, after he had really become established as a baker and probably was no longer living in a hole in the ground. But in any event, the exiled Prince of France, the fellow who would be King Louis Philippe, he was touring the country with his two brothers. And he had been on the move down from Pittsburgh and traveling throughout the frontier just to see what the country looked like. And he was pretty well chagrined, this French prince was, with the way he found the manners on the frontier. He said that he saw no persons of quality on the frontier at all. And he said, furthermore, they gave him lice and bedbugs at every opportunity. And they spoke a most uncivilized language. He could scarcely understand them. And when he gave them orders, they didn't obey. And so he was not a happy person by the time he got here to Marietta. And so he was so happy to find a civilized Frenchman here on the frontier, who spoke a civilized language. And of course, Mr. Therry, he was equally delighted to hear his beloved French spoken again in a tongue he could understand. And so they were just, you know, instant best friends, I'm sure. And so this is in February in cold weather. And so he says, nothing will do, but I'll bake you some bread such as you've not had since you left the streets of Paris. And so Louis Philippe was only too glad to have him do that. So while he was going to bake the bread, because, I mean, day-old stuff wouldn't do this, the prince, you know, Louis Philippe was going to look around over Marietta and see how things are. But Mother Nature intervened at this point, because what was happening is the ice in the Muskingum was breaking up. You see, the Muskingum would freeze over. Well, so would the Ohio, but the Ohio was open. There was a current open up and down the Ohio. But the Muskingum had been frozen solid, and that afternoon, before the Frenchman's bread was done, the Muskingum, there was this great booming and cracking and snapping of ice, and they knew the Muskingum was breaking up. And so the prince and his entourage was going to have to leave immediately, because once those great chunks of ice came booming out into the Ohio, they'd cut you to pieces. It cost you your life. So you were either going to be stuck in Marietta until the ice all got out of the Muskingum, or until it froze over again, or else you better get out there fast. And so the prince prepared to leave. Well, meanwhile, the bread was done, and so there was this dramatic scene of the little French baker, Mr. Therry, rushing with loaves of bread under each arm, and the crowd is cheering him on, and the ice is cracking and booming, and the people on the boat are shouting, and he manages to leap aboard just as it pulls away from the shore, and but there's no time for him to get back on shore. So down the river he goes with the prince's entourage, but the prince has his fresh bread. And the poor little baker, he doesn't get ashore until halfway to Gallipolis before he finally gets ashore and treks back overland to Marietta. But he's perfectly happy because he's got to ride, you know, with his countrymen and provide such a service as wonderful French bread. And indeed, the king, when he became king some 30 years later, and Francois Therry probably did not live to see his friend become king, but he did become king in, I believe, 1830. He was king from 1830 till, I think, 1848. And he wrote in his memoirs that he once, in the new country, he ran away with a baker once. And so that story made it into international history, so to speak. And it was our very own Francois Therry from here in Marietta who was the little French baker. And so it was that kind of spirit that I think showed up in the French people and was certainly a welcome input into the mix in the Ohio Valley. And there's a story told about Mrs. Therry, whose first name I don't know. But the story goes that New England, the proper New England ladies of Marietta, did not always approve of her. Because in the first place, she talked to everybody. Of course, nobody could understand her because she spoke French, but that didn't stop her. She talked to man, woman, child, beast, Indian, it didn't matter. She talked to everybody. And they didn't think that was quite right. And but the one thing she did that really, really, really got them wondering was she appeared in public in her husband's trousers. Now, the reason I think the poor woman probably did this is she probably only had one dress. She probably had to take it off and wash it once in a while, and there was nothing to do but put on her husband's extra trousers when she did. So I'm assuming that was probably the reason. But if that wasn't bad enough, and this I think is a wonderful, wonderful tribute to Mrs. Therry, is they said she had the habit of bursting into song at inappropriate moments. And I thought, you know, when I first read that, I thought, my goodness, I mean, here she is living at this point in time. She's living in a hole in the ground with a husband and two children. Her husband's unemployed. She doesn't have but one dress to her name. What in the world could this woman have to sing about, you know? But what a wonderful way to be remembered is that you burst into song at inappropriate moments. And to me, that's the spirit of the French 500. They continued. If you read the stories from Gallipolis, they continued to burst into song at inappropriate moments and thrive. And I thought that was just a wonderful, wonderful mix to put into the frontier.